Hey y'all, thanks for joining us today. If you'd like to know more about all that happens around here at LifePoint, then you need to download our new app. It's got everything from message notes, upcoming events, reading plans, and even the Sunday set list. We hope this series blesses you, so check this out.
And so over the course of 11 weeks, if you haven't been here for all of them, you can catch them online. But the heartbeat behind this Make Ready series is simply this, is how do we get ready for what God has made ready for us? It's understanding that God is a good God, and he has a great plan for your life and mine, but he probably didn't tell you what it is. And what that means is that you and I have to be faithful and walk in obedience to what God has instructed, and as we do that, we will experience what God has made ready for us. And so today, we're going to continue with this idea. And so to understand what's happening today, we've been studying through the nation of Israel under the leadership of this guy named Joshua. Now, last week, we looked at Joshua chapter 7. Today, we're going to be in Joshua chapter 10. So I want to give you a quick understanding of what happens between chapter 7 and chapter 10. So chapter 7, Israel goes to battle and they get their butts kicked by these people of Ai, or we call it Ai. So they get their butts kicked because one guy disobeyed the instructions of God. Now that's crazy to think about. One person's disobedience caused 36 people to lose their lives. The nation lost the battle. It was a big deal. And we know that that's true because we've all been impacted by somebody else's indiscretion or bad decisions, haven't we? You've grown up in a home where maybe mom or dad made a decision that wasn't healthy. We've all experienced somebody else's wrongdoings that had an impact on us. And it's important to note that our choices, they have ripple effects that reach into the lives of all those around us. And in chapter 7, Israel goes to battle just like they always did. They got their butts kicked. But then in chapter 8, with God's blessing and permission and guidance, they go back and they kick butt in God's name. And so they claim the victory. And then in chapter 9, their fame, Israel's fame is spreading, and these five kings west of the Jordan, they're like, man, nobody can stand against these Israelites. So let's band together. They form this super troop. They make an alliance. They're like, let's attack them collectively. We're better together. We're stronger together. Well, there's this one town called Gibeon that's not included into this plan. And so Gibeon realized, they're like, man, we've got no chance against the Israelites. So let's trick them into a treaty. So here's what Gibeon does. Pretty brilliant. So they understand that Israel is going to wipe off the face of the earth everyone that is in this promised land. So here's what we're gonna do. They send a handful of guys, and they make it look like they traveled from a faraway country. I mean, this is sneaky. They dress them in like, you know, just ripped clothes, you know, kind of like what's in style nowadays. They look like today's like a worship leader, possibly like Josh, who's here leading. So imagine, you know, holes in the jeans. And anyway, so their clothes are all torn. The food that they're carrying is, it's moldy, it's stale. They've got wineskins, and the wineskins are all dried out. Their sandals are ripped. They've been traveling for what looks like a long way. It's not very far. And they come up against the Israelites and Joshua, and they tell them, we've come from a long ways away. Please don't kill us. Make a treaty of peace with us. And so the Israelites are kind of inspecting them. They look like they've been traveling for a long time. And then the Bible says this in Joshua 9. Look at this. It says the Israelites sampled their provisions. They're like, oh, that is kind of old. That food is kind of crumbly and dry. But look at the rest of this. Read this out loud with me. It says they sampled their provisions, but, come on, everybody out loud, but did not inquire of the Lord. They didn't bother to say, hey, God, should we do this or not? You told us to wipe everyone out, but maybe we should go into a treaty. And they didn't inquire of the Lord, which I want you to know, there's nothing too big or too small. Maybe this seemed like a little thing to them, but there's nothing too big or too small to inquire of God about. God cares. And so they all of a sudden have got this alliance or this treaty with the people of Gibeon, only to discover that they are not from far away, that they're nearby. And that sets the tone for chapter 10, what we're gonna look at today. So if you've got your Bibles, go to Joshua chapter 10. If you don't have a Bible with you, you can open up your smartphone and go to the LifePoint app. You'll find the notes there. If you don't own a Bible, either of our locations, we'd love to give you a Bible today. So stop by our Next Steps area and say, hey, can I get a Bible? It's our gift to you. But in Joshua chapter 10, here's what the Bible says. It says, now Adoni-Zedek, king of Jerusalem, heard that Joshua had taken Ai and totally destroyed it, doing to Ai and its king as he had done to Jericho and its king. and that the people of Gibeon had made a treaty of peace with Israel and had become their allies. He and his people were very much alarmed at this because Gibeon was an important city, like one of the royal cities. It was larger than Ai, and its men were good fighters. So this king of Jerusalem's like, wait a second, Gibeon is on board with Israel? Gibeon's got like fighting men. This isn't good for us. So here's what he does. So Adoni-Zedek, king of Jerusalem, appealed to Hoham. How many of you know Hoham is a good name? That's a strong name. If you are pregnant right now, I triple dog dare you to name that young man Hoham. He will know how to fight, I promise you that. Hoham. On three, I want everybody, both locations, say Hoham. One, two, three, Hoham. That's just a good name, good name. So Adoni-Zedek, king of Jerusalem, appealed to Hoham, king of Hebron, Piram, king of Jarmuth, Japhia, king of Lachish, Debir, king of Eglon. He says, come up and help me attack Gibeon, he said, because it has made peace with Joshua and the Israelites. Then the five kings of the Amorites, the kings of Jerusalem, Hebron, Jarmuth, Lachish, and Eglon, joined forces. They moved up with all their troops and took up positions against Gibeon and attacked it. And so all of a sudden, the Gibeonites get word that these five kings have an alliance and are coming after them. And they're like, hey, Israel, you know that treaty of peace that we formed together? We need you. And what's interesting is that Israel keeps their word. They could have easily been like, man, y'all tricked us. No, thank you. You're on your own. But they kept their word. And God tells them, I will go to battle with you. Don't be afraid. I've given them into your hands. No one will be able to stand against you. That's what God says. All these kings coming against you, they don't stand a chance against you. Have you ever heard the saying, vengeance is mine, says the Lord? Have you ever heard that saying? Vengeance is mine. What it means is like God is good at fighting our battles. Well, check out what God does on behalf of Gibeon and the Israelites. Verse 9. After an all-night march from Gilgal, Joshua took them by surprise. So they've marched about 25 miles, okay? They've been headed out about 20. I mean, that's a long ways to walk. So these soldiers have marched 25 miles, and they have a sneak attack. They surprise them. Verse 10, the Lord threw them into confusion before Israel. So all of a sudden, Israel shows up, and these five kings and all their armies are confused. They don't know who is who, and it's obvious God is causing confusion amongst their ranks. So the Lord threw them into confusion before Israel. So Joshua and the Israelites defeated them completely at Gibeon. Israel pursued them along the road going up to Beth Horon and cut them down all the way to Azekah and Makkedah. As they fled before Israel on the road down from Beth Horon to Azekah, the Lord hurled large hailstones down on them. That is impressive right there. Talk about God fighting on your behalf. God is hurling large hailstones. So when I tell you God is better at fighting your battles than you are, trust me. Some of you were like, can I pray for God to do that? I got somebody in mind right now. Lord, do that hailstone thing again. I'm not telling you to pray that. That's between you and the Lord. He obviously did it here. So the Lord hurled large hailstones down on them, and more of them died from the hail than were killed by the swords of the Israelites. And so these enemy kings are on the run. Their soldiers are running, and the only hope they have is to outrun Israel until sunset. If the sun can go down, we can hide under the dark of the night. We can find caves. We can find hiding. I mean, back then, there's no flashlights. There's no artificial light. I mean, you are just hoping that you can get away and that the sun will set, and then under the dark of the night, you'll be able to get away. But hang on, not so fast. God's not done. Check out what happens next, verse 12. On the day the Lord gave the Amorites over to Israel, Joshua said to the Lord in the presence of Israel, check this out, sun stand still over Gibeon, and you moon over the valley of Ahalon. So the sun stood still. This is ridiculous. Joshua's like, I need a little more time. Hey God, pause the sun. And he did it. The sun stood still and the moon stopped till the nation avenged itself on its enemies, as it is written in the book of Jashar. Jashar is a book that documents these chronicles of the kings and battles. And we're told the sun stopped in the middle of the sky and delayed going down for a full day. There's never been a day like it before or since, a day when the Lord listened to a human being. Surely, check this out, surely the Lord was fighting for Israel. So I've titled this message, if you're taking notes, I want you to write this down. I've titled this message, When God Fights Your Battles. Would you write this down? When God fights your battles. There is something about God fighting for us. And I want you to know the same God that fights for Joshua and the Israelites fights for you and I today. So think about this. God has promised the victory to Joshua, to the Israelites. He's promised a victory to you as well. You are called a victor. You are more than a conqueror. God has victory ahead of you, but you don't have it yet. And so God has promised them victory. The battle is in full swing. The only hindrance to Israel, you know, completely annihilating them and claiming this victory is this lack of daylight, is the fact that the sun is setting. They're losing the opportunity. And so if they can maintain some sunlight, they can continue to win this battle. And with the setting sun, their opportunity is fading away. You know what it's like for your opportunity to fade away, right? You've had something that you were striving for, but it seemed as if that opportunity was beginning to slip away. You know God has a promise ahead of you. You're walking in faith. Maybe you're even beginning to see the victory, but it seems like you're running out of time. Like, God, I just put some more time on the clock. God, give me another 30 seconds. Give me another 5 minutes. Give me a little bit more to work with. God, I'm running out of time. And all of a sudden, we realize that as the buzzer goes off, like we lost our opportunity. Perhaps we missed it. Maybe for you, maybe there's a dream that you've possessed and you've started taking steps towards that dream, but it looks like there's not enough time to actually see it to fulfillment. Maybe you've been working on your marriage and it wasn't everything you hoped for, but you're taking steps and you're believing that God's gonna restore, but you just got some news that set you back and you're not exactly sure what to make of that. Or maybe there's a health situation that you're dealing with and the doctors were giving you a favorable reply and now they're like, we're not so sure, we've seen something else, we need you to come back in. And it seems like the opportunities are beginning to slip away. The clock is running out. That's where Israel's at. They're chasing these men down, but the sun is setting. And Joshua could have easily said, hey guys, that's all for today. Good job, good work. We'll try to find them tomorrow. But he didn't. He's faith-filled and he says something absolutely ridiculous. He says, sun, stand still. I mean, come on, sun, stand still. It's just crazy just to say it with me. Sun, stand still. Come on, Leland, let me hear you. Sun, stand still. It's a ridiculous request. Hold on, what do you mean, sun, stand still? And God does it. God responds to this ridiculous request. And here's what we learn. Four things I want us to take away from this passage today. When God fights our battles. When God fights your battles, I want you to write this down. When God fights your battles, messes become miracles. When God fights your battles, messes become miracles. You see, they were in a mess that they never should have been in. God did not instruct them to strike up a treaty with Gibeon. They didn't seek the Lord, and because of that, they're in a mess. This is Gibeon's battle, but now they're drawn into it as well. But God takes this mess and turns it into a miracle. Anybody here ever made a mess, like a royal mess? Like you meant well, but things got out of control. Like that escalated quickly. You ever been there? So about a year ago, I was in my kitchen and our garbage disposal hadn't worked in years. Years, you know, you flip the switch, nothing happens. And I did everything I could think of to try to get this thing fixed. I mean, I had made sure it wasn't clogged up. I kicked it. I unplugged it. I flipped the breaker. Nothing. Well, one evening my wife says, honey, the sink won't drain. She's like, I don't know if something's down in there. And so I'm like, you know, I'll do what I can. I'm not the most handy guy, but I'll figure this out. So I did what any guy would do. I stuck my hand down in the garbage disposal. Right now, I turned it off, okay? Some of you were like, no, you didn't. Like, it hasn't worked in years. What's the chance of it firing back up with my fingers in there? Like, I fixed it. Good news and bad news, baby. So I turned it off. I put my hand down in there. And I don't know, this was probably the original garbage disposal, so we're talking 20 years. It was like putting my hand into a swamp. And I started feeling around, and I was dislodging years of black stuff. The sink started filling up with this, it smelled like death. I mean, I can only get so far away because I'm up to the elbow, and I can't seem to get it dislodged. I don't know what's going on. And finally, I'm like, you know what? I'm just gonna go get a new garbage disposal. Enough with this. They're only like $100. I'll go get one. My wife will be impressed at what a manly man I am. It's gonna be great. It's a win-win. So I, kind of get out and I'm like, all right, baby, I'll be back in a minute. And I run to Home Depot. It's right around the corner. And I get a garbage disposal, come back. And I am trying to figure out how to get this garbage disposal disconnected. I mean, come on, have you ever laid under your kitchen sink and worked on anything? That is the worst position. You're like, I mean, your back is instantly broken. It's horrible. And you're trying to work around these pipes. And so I'm yanking and yanking. And then I have this thought like, if I get this disconnected, everything that's in the sink will now be under the sink. Always thinking. Always thinking. So I go and I get this plastic tub, and it can only be so big because it's got to fit under the pipes, and I get it under there, and I'm yanking, 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 and all of a sudden I disconnect it, and the water from the sink begins to pour out like a fire hose. I mean, it's just... And it is, my tub is clearly not doing its job. It's hitting that. It's bouncing everywhere. It's all over me. And it's just, I mean, it reeks to high heaven. It's horrible. But I get it drained. And then I take this tub and I'm like, what do I do with this? Like, I got to dump this somewhere. And here's the crazy thing. So I was, the sink was all nasty. So I, you know, in a moment, I was like, I'll rinse the sink out. So I flipped the sink on, realizing nothing was connected. So now water's running down. My tub was still there. So it was okay. So then I take the tub and I'm like, where do I dump this thing? And so I'm thinking, I can't just dump it outside. My dogs will find it, roll in it, and we will live with this stench for the next couple months. So I'm like, I'll just go dump it over the fence. I've got a fence in my backyard. So I'm carrying this tub, and it's really awkward. It's sloshing around. And I lift it up to go up over the fence. And as I do, it tilts backwards, thus dumping all of that black water of death down my arms, down my chin, down my stomach. It is absolutely rancid. I'm coming back in the house. I'm like, baby, I love you and these kids, because if I didn't, I'd be out of here right now. And so I, you know, long story short, go to Home Depot, get a new garbage disposal, get it all in there, you know, flip the switch. The thing is working. I am like, I am the man. My wife is gonna love me more than ever. And I, you know, could clean up, sit back, kick my feet up on the couch. Of course, I posted a picture of it because if it's not on the internet, it didn't happen. And then somebody's like, hey, just make sure you disconnect or you knocked out the plastic drain plug that runs from the dishwasher. I'm like, oh, man. Reverse the process. Anyway, long story short, it was a mess. I mean, it stunk. It was everywhere. And so if you've ever made a mess out of life, I mean, you know. Like, it didn't have to be that messy. That's just the way I did things. And Israel's in this mess. And it's their fault. And we live in a world that's like, well, you got yourself into that mess. Get yourself out of it. I'm thankful that God doesn't work that way. I'm thankful that God's like, hey, you're in a mess, but I can still work a miracle. And I want you to know, you may be in a mess right now, but God can still work a miracle on your behalf. You don't have to get yourself out of that mess before God will step in. Some of us, we're looking at finances right now, and we're like, man, you know, 72 months, 0%. It made sense, seemed legit. And now you're like, why in the world did I get in that? 12 months, same as cash. And you're in a financial place you wish you had never gotten into, and it's a mess, and you can't pin it on God or anybody else. That was just you. It was impulse. And you're like, well, what do I do now? Here's what I want you to know. God will meet you in the middle of that mess. Maybe your relationship, you've neglected your spouse for years, and there's a distance there. You can't pin that one on God. That's on you, but God still cares about you. He's not gonna abandon you. In that mess, he loves you right where you are, that he will work a miracle in the middle of your mess. It's a mess that set the stage for God to do this amazing miracle. Messes become miracles when God fights our battles. Here's the second thing I want you to know. When God fights our battles, the impossible becomes possible. Would you write that down? When God fights your battles, the impossible becomes possible. I mean, Joshua asked for the sun to stand still. Come on. That's ridiculous. He asked for something that had never been done before. Never seen it done before. All he knew is, I need a little more daylight. Hey, God, sun, stand still. Pause. I mean, he straight DVR'd the sun, right? Stopped it right there. Now, I mean, that's just a bold request. Now, I know some of you are sitting here, and I just got to think, if I'm Joshua, right, I made this request, but here's what's interesting. He didn't just make this request in private. Like, this is the kind of thing I would pray when I'm in my closet all by myself. Like, all right, God, now that nobody can hear me, here's what I'm asking for. And it would be big and it would be bold. But he's like in front of everybody, in front of all the Israelites. He's like, God, sun, stand still. I imagine somebody was like, technically, Joshua, God can't do that. Because you see, the sun's the center of the universe. Everything's revolving around it. And so if it's not the sun stands still, God, you know, Joshua, what you really want is the earth to stand still. But if the earth stands still, it's going to throw off the gravitational force of everything and we're all going to die. So... this is kind of an impossible request. Some of you, you know somebody like that, don't you? Are you sitting next to them right now? Don't look at them. Don't look at them. You know they're like, they get all technical and everything. Well, technically, here's my deal. The very God that hung the sun in the sky, he can hit pause if he wants to. He can hit pause if he wants to. It was impossible. Impossible. The impossible becomes possible when God fights our battles. This is an impossible request. My My situation is impossible. It's impossible for me to get the promotion. It's impossible for me to make ends meet. You don't understand. No. We serve a God that turns the impossible into possible when we let God fight our battles. Here's the third thing. When God fights your battles, your faith grows. When God fights your battles, your faith grows. It takes faith to ask for the impossible. If what you're facing can be managed in your own ability, it doesn't require faith. When you're up against something bigger than you, it takes faith. I like what Oliver Wendell Holmes says. He says, a mind that is stretched by a new experience can never go back to its old dimensions. I would add that faith that is stretched by a new experience will never go back to its old dimensions. When was the last time you stretched your faith? When was the last time you believed God for something that nobody else could see as a possibility? When was the last time you said, God, I don't see how this will ever work, but I am trusting you. I am stepping out, believing that you're gonna step in. When was the last time? When was the last time you prayed a bold prayer that you didn't know how God would answer? When was the last time you sacrificially gave to somebody else not knowing how the means were gonna all come together? When was the last time you stretched your faith? I think about this story in Mark chapter 9 where this dad has this son who's being tormented by a demon, and he brings his son to the disciples and they can't cast this demon out. So he does the next thing and he brings him to Jesus. And he's like, Jesus, here's my son. My son's got some issues. And Jesus says, well, how long has he been like this? And in Mark chapter 9, we see his answer. He says, from childhood. This demon, it's often thrown him into the fire or water to kill him. But I like this. He says, Jesus, he's talking to Jesus, but if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. Now it's like, do you know who you're talking to? Jesus, if you can do anything, look at Jesus' response. If you can, said Jesus. Read this next part out loud with me, ready? Everything is possible for one who believes. Everything is possible for one who believes. And I love the father's response. Immediately the boy's father exclaimed, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. What he's saying is grow my faith. I do believe. I know you're capable. I know you're able. I'm having a hard time, you know, reconciling how you're gonna do this. And this is where I think a lot of us find ourselves. God, I'm facing these situations, these circumstances. I don't know how it's gonna work. But God, I believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. Grow my faith, God. Grow my faith. Everything is possible for the one who believes. And here's the thing. If you believe that all things are possible, you will begin to pray for the impossible. Let me say that again. That's for somebody today. If you truly believe that with God all things are possible, you're not afraid to pray for the impossible. Well, I don't know that, you know, I've never seen a marriage get restored like that. That's a mess. Oh, no. I have a God who raises the dead to life. This is possible. With man, this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. What is it that you're believing God for? I like what Mark Batterson says. Mark Batterson is an author, a pastor, and he says this. He says, bold prayers honor God, and God honors bold prayers. God isn't offended by your biggest dreams or boldest prayers. He's offended by anything less. If your prayers aren't impossible to you, they are insulting to God. Let's talk to God about big things. Let's go to God about big challenges. Let's go to God about obstacles and opposition that are bigger than we are, knowing that they're not bigger than he is. Our faith grows when God fights our battles. And here's the last, fourth and final, I share this in closing. When God fights our battles, victory is a certainty. Victory is a certainty. They already knew that the victory was theirs. They just had to show up. God had promised it. Listen, they did not fight for victory. They were fighting from victory. Big difference. When you're fighting for victory, it is uncertain. But when you're fighting from victory, a place of victory, you have certainty. You have confidence. Can I tell you, God has gone before you. The battle is won. The victory is yours. That's what the scriptures say. And if you could get a glimpse into the circumstances and battles that are ahead of you, you'd walk with a little more confidence, a little more swagger, knowing that God is gonna show up. God is working. He is gonna bring about a victory. Victory is a certainty. We don't fight for it, we fight from it. I think about our relationship with our Lord. Did you know that the only way you and I can have a relationship with our Father in heaven is because of the victory of Jesus? That when Jesus went to the cross, he won. He defeated sin, death, and the grave. He created a way that you and I could be in a relationship with God, because in our own strength, it was impossible. In our own strength, we try and try and try to do enough good things to get God to approve of us. But God will never approve of our life because there is sin in the way. But Jesus took the sin on him and he defeated it there on the cross. His death, burial, and resurrection gives us the victory. We have victory. We're not striving for it. We are living from it. It's a big difference. And I want you to know that what is impossible with man became possible because of what Jesus did. You know, maybe today you're thinking about the battles that lay ahead. Maybe this week, maybe there's conversations that have got to happen and you don't want to have them. God's already gone before you. If you'll listen to him, if you'll walk in obedience, you'll be able to step into the victory that he has for you. Maybe you're looking at situations going, I just don't see how God could ever work on my behalf. Maybe you've never had maybe you've never had a moment where you put your faith and trust in Jesus. And you're wondering, I just don't know if God will work. Can I tell you, God has worked. He will work. He is working on your behalf. He loves you right where you are. The greatest battle in our life, the battle for our salvation, has already been won. And it tells me that he's got a good, pleasing, perfect plan for my life. He's gone before me. There is victory ahead of me. It's gonna require a bold prayer. Son, stand still. I don't know what your circumstances are, but I know the same God that answered that prayer can answer yours as well. And I would love nothing more than to close out our time together. First off, giving you an opportunity to begin a relationship with God. If you've never made a commitment to Jesus, this is the most important decision you'll ever make. And then we're gonna take a moment. I wanna pray over the impossible situations right now in our church, believing that today is going to unlock victories for so many. So would you bow your heads and close your eyes? Would you pray with me? With our heads bowed and eyes closed, I just want to give you this moment and this opportunity. If today you would say, I've never taken the moment, I've never realized that what Jesus did on the cross, he did for me. If you've never come to that understanding before and you realize it today, I want to give you the opportunity to say yes to Jesus. The Bible says that if we would declare with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, if we would believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, that we will be saved. That means you can be forgiven. You can receive an eternity in heaven. And I want you to know you can do that right now. So wherever you are, whatever your background story, this is your moment to say yes to Jesus. With heads bowed and eyes closed, both of our locations and those of you watching online, if you need to say yes to Jesus, would you make this your prayer? In the quietness of your heart, say, Dear God, I give you my life today. I receive forgiveness today. I put my faith and my trust in Jesus. I receive your Holy Spirit. Fill me with courage and confidence. Help me to live for you. Say this, say, thank you for saving me.